Really? But look at the times or the.
And I don't think God blesses him for that because he steals from people.
Again, I think it's just a, all of it is just a test of character and the condition of a heart. God says he reigns on the just and the unjust. And so he prospers the just, he prospers the unjust. But it's how we're going to deal with it and how we're going to deal with somebody else dealing with it.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's all just a circle of tests to solidify a Christian's character, someone who's being saved. What's your character going to be? Are you going to judge? Or are you not going to judge? Because you're going to be judged the same way that you're judged.
Right. And, you know, when it comes to insurmountable wealth, if you will, you know, some of these people would have had, you know, they would have climbed up through the ranks of $100,000, $200,000, and through good investments, good techniques, it automatically builds itself up to a million and a billion. Some of it, they, you know, the organizations are structured in such a way that they can't help but make money. Through no fault of their own, but through good planning, you know, in years previous. But an article I read the other day said that Bill Gates, for example, may become the world's first trillionaire. Now, he's a fair ways away from it right now, but you know, if somebody could do it, I don't know why he couldn't. But again, you take somebody like Bill Gates, just using them for an example, is we don't know how they minister to others. You know, just like it says earlier here in Matthew, you know, whatever you're doing, you know, whether you're praying or whether you're giving, do it without anybody else knowing. So while on the surface, and I guess it'd be a bad thing, if on the surface we have a negative opinion of somebody because they are so filthy, stinking rich, in our opinion, we have no idea. They could be the God's best giving philanthropist you would ever know about. But because they follow the scripture, if they're following the scripture, we don't know that. And yet their wealth continues to grow. Again, like it says previously, test God. This is one of the areas where you can test God is in your giving. And he says, the more you can't outgive me. The more you give, the more I'll bless you. So, you know, that's a different take or a different, you know, twist on wealth. But again, it goes back to, yes, your entire attitude about it. Hoarding, greed, selfishness, not helping the underprivileged, helping the poor. Get back to the book of James, you know, on that.
You know, one thing about wealth is perspective. We are all wealthy people if you come from some places in Africa. Mm-hmm. If it comes from some places, they would be happy to have, you know, a $10 a week job. That's more than they make now.
Definitely.
And when we end up with, you know, carrying around $100 in your wallet, they're saying, that is wealth. What do they need all that money for?
Put it in perspective, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
You know, I really commend some pastors, though, because we have seen pastors that had the opportunity, and Christian singers who have gotten very big, and like Mullins and Steve, is it Green
Keith,
and yeah. Keith Green, have gotten very big and have had big amounts of money coming in. But you know what? They have come to that decision, and that's an individual decision. But they came to that decision where they said, okay, you know what? I'm turning this over to the church or some board or something, and you guys pay me a reasonable amount of money a year because I don't want to be responsible for all this. And I really commend those guys because I saw Mark Bunting over there in India, and I got to visit his church when I was over there. But he chose to live on, I mean, he lived in the same apartment for years and years and years, and the church got very big, and then a lot of money came into that, but they wanted to give him a lot of money. But he said, no, you know, I don't need that. I, you know, so much to live, and but you know, get it out to the people who need it. You know, use it here. These artists, they just came to that point where they said, no, I don't want that kind of responsibility. I don't know what it'll do to me. I don't know, you know, and I just commend those kind of guys because they are an example. Because sometimes it is embarrassing when the world looks at someone who's got $500 million and he's in the ministry. And they go, because it's not really a very good witness because they're saying, wait a minute now. Because as the world sees it, they're saying, wait a minute now, that just doesn't make any sense. You're begging for $100,000 to save someone, and to you, that pastor, that is nothing. That's chunk change out of your bank, you know, but yet you're begging. Because I had nursing homes, and I saw the little ladies who only got $30 a month allowance in those nursing homes, and they'd send $25 of that $30 a month to the ministries, and they're giving it out, and you know, you're seeing some people receiving so much. So anyway, I do commend the people who do come to that point and say, you know what, I don't need all this. Let's put it to where it needs to be. Now, that's everybody's an individual, and they have to deal with that in their own heart. And as long as, because we do have to be careful. If all of a sudden we do have that kind of money coming in, it could change us. Just like people who win lotteries. You've seen story after story of lives that have been destroyed simply because they all of a sudden had that money come in.
I think part of it, I think for me, the downside to that would be, is it's nice to see these pastors and ministries being blessed with untold wealth. I would find it unfortunate if they were to use my way of thinking that, how is it going to look for me and my ministry to have this much money, maybe not the ministry, but me, you know, as a pastor or a layman in the church, to have that much money and people think negatively of me because I have been blessed with that kind of a reward.
But what good does it do if it's just sitting in a bank?
Yeah.
True.
It should flow through. I mean, it shouldn't just all of a sudden
stop
somewhere, you know. And it's like, what good? It's just like everybody else that do have, they have all this money, and if they're not continuing to keep this thing flowing, that's when the economy starts slowing down because that they want to see those numbers growing in their bank account, and it just sits there and it's not moving through the economy, and you know, it's just, I don't know.
I like sitting at an auction sometimes when you see those numbers. You know, there's only one, you just want to see those numbers go up. Dessa, yeah. And then Brandy.
Oh. And I've seen people too that their calling wasn't to be a preacher, but because they have seen ministry people making six figures, yeah, they're like, oh, well, I can go and be a preacher and make six figures. Yeah. When there is no way he should be a preacher.
Right. I'm wondering if Brian's still a pen pal with Mrs. Baker. Brandon?
I was just looking up at the scripture, and I don't think it was an accident that they put 21, 22, and 23 together. You know, it talks about, it goes from money, and then it goes into the condition of your soul. You know, the light and the light and the darkness. Mm-hmm. Well, money is also a reflection of the light and darkness that is in your soul.
Exactly.
So those are parallel. I mean, it's not an accident that those two were put together.
You know, when they say, you know, the eyes are the window to the soul. Yeah, if you have good, good healthy eyes, you know, in this metaphor, good healthy eyes, and they're bright, they're showing you the way. They're keeping you in line.
And also your money will do the same thing.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. Make it very apparent where your heart is.
Definitely. Anybody else? Susie, what was you going to say?
Well, I think that one reason that people look at ministers that get rich is because of their personal perception of what a minister is supposed to be. And I mean, we heard one man on one board in a church we were at, he said, you should keep ministers poor so they'll do their job. And I thought, that's very interesting to say, you know, but there's a lot of people with that attitude that if a minister gets too much money, they're not, I mean, they're not doing the job anyway. I heard some say, you know, they just get up and they give a message on Sunday, and then what do they do the rest of the week? Well, maybe some of them don't do anything. But I have heard that, and I thought, they don't realize what a responsibility is that these ministers have. And if they get blessed in what they're doing so that they can do more of it, I don't have a problem with anything.
I think it's with a wealthy person's money, the same thing with a pastor's time.
That's right.
Is, you know, what are they doing with it?
Yeah.
And there's a lot of times, you know, when I've, in years gone by, you know, from the outside looking in, what does my pastor do? I don't see him doing anything. I don't hear about him making calls. I don't hear about him making visitations. And yeah, you start getting a little closer, and you go, do all these people that are complaining about, you know, him not doing anything, do they know what's going on? Do they know the conviction that the pastor has? Do they know the love that the pastor has when it comes to, you may not see it, you may not even hear about it, but does that mean they're not doing it? But you know, I,
that's right.
Keeping them poor, I don't, that's a hard one to stomach.
One man said, and I didn't agree with him.
I'm going to chase one of Dennis's rabbits down a trail. Reminds me of when I was attending a Baptist church, and I was just a kid. And our pastor, the new pastor and his family came in to take over the church. And I think he was about 27, 28 years old. Nice couple, nice little kids. And he was driving a Chevelle, a ragtop two-door Chevelle. And boy, was it pretty. And it sounded nice. And about 3 months after he came into the church, the Chevelle was gone. Now, that wasn't their only car. She had one of her own. But found out through my dad, you know, over here in some of his conversations, that the reason the pastor had it, he had to get rid of the Chevelle because too many people in the church were bitching and moaning that that is not an appropriate vehicle for a pastor to drive. Well, depending on your upbringing or your train of thought, it's like mine is like, too bad. You don't like it, go to the church down the street. Because it's what's up here and what the man is delivering, that's what counts. Not that beautiful cherry red Chevelle parked in the parking lot.
And also, what sometimes what really counts is, who cares what he is or is not doing? What are you doing or what are you not doing?
Right.
You know, that's the real issue. You know, because if the body's functioning properly, then it doesn't all hinge on the leadership. Leadership's there to guide, correct. The body's there to function.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. Yes?
I was going to say, the best example that I've seen is when someone walks downtown with brand new boots and walks home in their stocking feet. And I have a friend that there wasn't, in his house he has a chair, he has a dining table. I mean, he has just the sparsest little. But the thing is, every time he gets something, and he does get blessed all the time. People give him things. But I'll tell you, and I've given him many things too, but I'll tell you, you go back the next week and say, well, where's your whatever I gave him to? He said, oh, well, I blessed someone with it. You know, I mean, it just blows right through him. You know, and I've seen him many a time walking around stocking footed because he said, well, what size you wear? You know, I've been with him. Well, what's this? And he never buys anything cheap. He'll buy $200-$400 boots, and he'll have them just a week, and then he's walking home stocking footed. And I mean, that is such a witness. I just love that.
You think Elvis was like that? Well, that was his meaning when he was giving Cadillacs away?
I don't know.
Man looks at the outside, but God looks at the heart.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. That's right.
Dessa?
No, I'm good.
Oh. So, as we get out of the treasures in heaven, there's a couple of takeaways from there. And one of them is, and I'm going to go back to that, is God doesn't say you can't have a bunch of stuff or a bunch of money. It's how you use it and what's up here and what's in here.
Gary, I want to make one comment, can I? You know,
is that okay, Susie?
Is that all right?
Say it twice.
You know, if you look at someone, let's say a pastor, and I won't use any name or anything, but that has made a lot of money, and he has a ministry. We don't know what God is doing through that ministry, how many lives are touched by that. He's going to have to deal with the Lord, with what he does with his money. But because of that pastor, all this ministry is taking place down here, and there's souls being touched, there's lives being touched, you know, and there's souls being brought to the Lord. So we shouldn't be one to look and say, this is not right. It's not ours to judge.
Right.
You know, the Lord will deal with him when his time comes. So if his heart's not right, the Lord will deal with it.
Yeah.
You know, so but all that ministry that takes place in the lower levels is what the Lord looks at.
And we'll be judged more severely for criticizing someone else with what they do with their money. And that person will be, regardless of what they did with their money.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And I think that's part of the temptation. When we talk about people being tempted, I think part of the judgment is going to be those of us that are looking in, criticizing someone else's ministry. And the Lord's going to say, and what did you do?
Kind of like what Brandon brought up, you know, is... You know, we're a body of that church. We're a member of that church. We're a member of that ministry. And what are we doing to try and help uplift it, help keep it going, help keep it driven? Right.
The pastor's like the brain, and we're like the body. We got to do the work and the actions, and he's there to guide and direct. And put the body in its place, but, you know, make it available for them to do the work. He's not there to do the work.
Mm-hmm.
Tell Dennis that.
Right? That's what I was thinking. When you see ministries that are doing something, plant seeds in those ministries.
Absolutely.
We absolutely plant seeds in ministries that come alongside, do whatever we can, and give monthly if we can, and work the Lord tells us to, or make a big, you know, do something big while you're there, or do something to support those ministries, to encourage them so they can continue on, because people may just be judging them all the time. They may be on their last leg. They may need your $50. They may need your encouragement. But if the Lord's got them planted there to do that job, and you see that they're doing the job, he tells you to do something, you help them out. And don't just worry about how much money somebody's making or any of that stuff. If God says you be a part of it, you be a part of it. And
there's a wonderful message out there about tithing. Tithing, offering, gifts, whatever the word of choice is, you know, for the individual. And that is,
those are three different things. Tithing, offerings, and gifts are three different things.
And how you present it. You know, towards, you know, planting the seed, towards the body of the church, towards the ministry, and what we talked, you know, touched on before also, you know, besides, you know, time and talents, but we don't know, like you said, you know, we don't know, you know, what the ministry needs, how much they need, but if you take money, for example, and you write out that check, or you put that money in the envelope, we're supposed to rejoice and be glad, almost to the point of laughter, saying, God, I would just love to see what you're going to do with this. You know, if I could, I would just love to see what you're going to do with this. I want to see how you bless people. I want to see how you work in the ministry, you know, how they're planting the seed, witnessing, bringing people to Christ. That would be a wonderful thing, I think, sometimes.
You know, I loved what Brian said about, you know, the little old ladies that's in the nursing